alkyl halides. Okay, in that third method is halogen exchange reactions. In this halogen exchange reactions, we are mainly going to prepare alkyl iodides and fluorides from their respective chlorides and bromides, because iodination, you know that it is reversible reaction, and fluorination, it is taking like you'll get a mono di tetra penta fluorinated compounds, polyhalogenated compounds you'll get if you do direct fluorination, because fluorine is highly reactive. So we are going for the best suitable methods to prepare iodides, alkyl iodides and alkyl fluorides. In that, first one is Finkelstein reaction. First one is Finkelstein reaction. Now what is Finkelstein reaction? Is alkyl chlorides or bromides. Here X is chloride or bromide. On treating with sodium iodide in dry acetone, produces alkyl iodides. This is called Finkelstein reaction. That is preparation of alkyl iodides from their respective chlorides or bromides by treating with sodium iodide in dry acetone is called Finkelstein reaction. And in this reaction, sodium halides get precipitated. Okay, so that is why you will get a more amount of iodides, or the product formation will be more, because according to Lee-Chatelier principle, equilibrium shifts forward direction, because always there is NaX precipitation. So that is Finkelstein reaction. One common basic example, let us take methyl chloride reacts with sodium iodide in dry acetone. Okay, in dry acetone it is converted into methyl iodide plus NaCl. This is called as Finkelstein reaction. Okay, then we have next reaction, that is Schwartz reaction. Next one is Schwartz reaction. Now what is Schwartz reaction? Okay, conversion of alkyl chlorides or bromides to their respective fluorides by heating with metal fluorides like, for example, silver fluoride or mercurous fluoride, anyone you can use, or cobalt fluoride, or you can also use antimony trifluoride. Any of these fluorides you can use for conversion of alkyl fluorides or bromides into the respective alkyl fluorides. So that is a Schwartz reaction. One simple example again you will write, that is methyl chloride on treating with silver fluoride gives rise to methyl fluoride plus AgCl. This is called Schwartz reaction. Okay. Now we will talk about the properties of alkyl halides. Properties of alkyl halides. Okay. Now, as you know, the bond between the carbon and halogen is polar. Why? Because halogen is more electronegative, carbon is less electronegative. So, partial negative charge and partial positive charge arises on the carbon and the halogen. So, you know that it is polar. Now, coming to the physical properties of alkyl halides. So, in that, smaller or simple alkyl halides, like for example methyl chloride, methyl bromide or ethyl chloride, simple alkyl halides are gases, exist as gases at a room temperature. Whereas higher haloalkanes, higher alkyl halides, okay, other than this ethyl, from ethyl or from propyl onwards, higher alkyl halides exist as, they exist as liquids or solids at a room temperature. Okay. And volatile alkyl halides, are generally sweet smelling. They have pleasant odor, you can say. Okay, volatile alkyl halides. And mostly pure alkyl halides, means alkyl halides when they are in pure state without any contamination, they are colorless. But alkyl bromides and iodides, they develop color, or they changes, or they change their color on standing or in presence of light. Alkyl iodides develops color, due to liberation of iodine in presence of light, because you know that iodination is reversible. So that's why alkyl iodides, if you project some light on them, or if you keep them in under normal ordinary light, what happens? They can liberate iodine and they can change the color. Coming to the next properties, that is about their boiling points. Basically, boiling point increases with the increase in the number of carbon atoms, and halogen atoms also. So as the number of carbons are increasing, or as the number of halogen atoms are increasing, what will happen? Molar mass increases, molecular weight increases, molar mass increases. So as the number of atoms and molar masses are increasing, or as the size of the halogens also increasing, van der Waals force of attraction forces increases, therefore boiling points increases. Okay, so basically if the alkyl group is same alkyl group, means if R remains constant, then you remember that alkyl iodides have more boiling point then compared to alkyl bromides, then compared to chlorides, then compared to fluorides. So if alkyl group remains constant, means if R is, for example, methyl iodide boiling point is greater than methyl bromide boiling point is greater than methyl chloride boiling point will be greater than methyl fluoride. Why? Because as the halogen's size is increasing and their atomic molar masses are increasing, their van der Waals forces increases as well as their boiling points also increases. That's why iodides have more boiling point than the respective fluorides. Okay. Coming to the next, as the branching increases. Okay, as the branching increases in case of isomeric halides. Okay, boiling points decreases due to decrease in van der Waals force of attraction. Example, we have N-butyl chloride and isobutyl chloride and tertiary butyl chloride. You know, this is linear straight chain. This is somewhat a branched. This is a more branched. This is more branched, right? What happens in straight chain? The number of van der Waals interactions between the atoms will be more. More van der Waals attractions will be there between the atoms. When the branching occurs, what is happening? Some atoms get hindered, so van der Waals attraction decreases. Here also, in this branching, this carbon atom is completely hindered. It is not doing any van der Waals force of attraction. Okay, so that means as the branching increases, what is happening? Number of van der Waals forces decreases. If van der Waals force decreases, automatically the respective boiling points also decreases. So N-butyl chloride, N-chlorobutane, you can say, is having more boiling point. Okay, then isobutyl chloride, then tertiary butyl chloride. So that is, if branching increases, boiling points decreases due to decrease in the van der Waals force of attraction. Okay, so this is the case with the branching structures. Then coming to next, we will see now coming to the case of dihalo benzenes. For example, here I am taking ortho dichlorobenzene meta dichlorobenzene and para dichlorobenzene ortho dichlorobenzene meta dichlorobenzene and para dichlorobenzene. So this is ortho isomer, it is meta isomer, it is para isomer. Now what we have found is the boiling points of all these three isomers are almost same. They are almost same, they have same boiling points, but we have noted that melting point of para isomer, melting point of the para isomer is greater than the ortho and meta isomers in case of dichlorobenzenes. They have noted that para dichlorobenzene, para isomer, is having more melting point than ortho and meta isomer. Why? Because the para dichlorobenzene will fit into crystal lattice almost perfectly than compared to the respective ortho and meta isomers. So why para isomer is having more melting point means it forms a almost perfect crystal lattice. It fits into the lattice properly compared to the ortho and meta isomers. That's why melting point order is para isomers having more melting point compared to ortho and meta, whereas boiling points are almost same for all these isomers. Okay, coming to the density, as the number of carbons and halogen atoms, increases, their density also increases. So molar mass increases, density increases. Coming to the solubility of alkyl halides, even though alkyl halides are polar, they are insoluble in water. They are insoluble in water. Why? Because this CX polar bond which is there, it cannot break the hydrogen bonds between water molecules. Okay, see, if it has to interact with this, what should happen here? They should first break the interaction between the hydrogen bonds in between the water molecules. So this hydrogen bonding in between the water molecules, cannot be broken by CX bonds or this polar bond. It doesn't have that much enthalpy, bond enthalpy to break the existing hydrogen bonds and incorporate itself, or it can form to form new hydrogen bond. That's why even though this alkyl halides have polar bonds, they cannot incorporate themselves with the hydrogen bonds of water. They cannot cleave the hydrogen bonds of water, and they cannot make a new hydrogen bonding with the water. That's why they are insoluble in water. But alkyl halides are soluble. They are soluble in organic. They are soluble in organic solvents. They are soluble in organic solvents. Okay. Here I can use. Okay. Now, coming to the chemical properties, chemical properties of alkyl halides. Alkyl halides basically undergo mainly three types of reactions. Those are nucleophilic substitution, reactions, elimination reactions, and some reactions with metals. So these are mainly three kinds of reactions we are going to see in chemical properties of alkyl halides. So they will undergo nucleophilic substitution reactions, they will undergo elimination reactions, and they will also react with some metals. Okay. Now the first kind of reactions are nucleophilic substitution. Nucleophilic substitution reactions. Now in the first year we have studied about the types of reactions. In that, one of the type we have seen substitution reactions. In substitution, again we have studied three types: electrophilic substitution, nucleophilic substitution, and free radical substitution. Here we are studying nucleophilic substitution. Now what is nucleophilic substitution? If the substitution is initiated by the nucleophile, or if one of the nucleophile from the substrate is substituted by another nucleophile, then such type of substitutions are called nucleophilic substitution reactions. Let us take one small example, like you are having some Rx. Rx reacts with some nucleophile. I am not writing a type of nucleophile, the general representation of nucleophile I am writing. So Rx plus Nu minus nucleophile gives rise to RNu plus X minus. So what does you observe here? Here X minus is replaced by Nu minus, right? That is substitution of one nucleophile with another nucleophile. Okay, so this type of reactions are called as what? Nucleophilic substitution reactions. In that, you can say why this nucleophilic substitution is occurring in this alkyl halides means. In alkyl halides, we have studied that the nature of the CX bond is polar nature. Okay? The nature of the CX bond is polar nature. So polar nature means what here? X will be always carrying partial negative charge. Carbon will be always carrying partial positive charge. So this partial positive charge can always attract a stronger nucleophile. And you know that halogens are easy leaving groups, or they are weaker nucleophiles. They can be replaced by any other strong nucleophile. So this polarity in the alkyl halides is mainly responsible for nucleophilic substitution reactions. Now let us see few examples for nucleophilic substitution reactions. In that, the first example I am writing here, general example I am taking, Rx. Rx plus alcoholic KCN, potassium cyanide. Now you know that in KCN, K plus and CN minus ions will be present. CN minus ion, cyanide ion, is nucleophile. So what is the product obtained here? This X minus should be replaced with the CN minus. That means RCN plus KX must be the products. Right? So what is happening? Halogen atom is replaced with cyanide. So this is one nucleophilic reaction. For example, let us take methyl chloride on reaction with the KCN. On reaction with KCN, what are the products I will get? I will get methyl cyanide. Methyl cyanide plus KCl. Okay?